to another solo edition of the podcast. Kiddos, we're in the podcast, just me and the little camera up there. It's kind of a trip talking to a camera with nobody else around and trying to make it seem like you're not reading something. Anyway, I'm giving it a try. It's a weird thing doing this podcast, but it's fun. Today we're going to cover a few things. I got a little quick animation study about one of my favorite basketball players of all time. Julia starts a drawing. That's a drawing that Julia and I worked on together, and I'm going to show you that. And then I'm going to talk about some little flaming going on in my YouTube channel regarding Sabutio or table soccer. Just fun banter about that. Anyway, I thought I'd show you my desk today, and just for the heck of it. And so here it is. Ta-da! This is where all the damage is done. I got an Apple computer, and I draw strictly on the computer now. I don't usually have paper around or pencils or pens and stuff like that. I miss it. Don't get me wrong. I love chalks and charcoal, things like that, but just kind of gave it up for convenience sake for now. So here's my desk. I use a Wacom tablet. I got a Blue Ball microphone. Here's my little Wacom pen. Got some headphones for doing the sound and stuff so I don't disrupt the whole house while I'm working on it. What else? Here's the screen. Out there is some nice sunshine that I should be enjoying, but I don't get enough of. And then I just have junk around. It's amazing the amount of wires and crap that'll pile up. And this is kind of actually like organized a little bit. So I cleaned up a little bit to have you guys here. And what else? Here's my keyboard and a nice cup of Joe. Cheers. So this is my studio, the Pod Cave. Welcome. Let's carry on with the rest.
Okay. I saw this cool video on Facebook where this little girl took a paintbrush and just made a scribble, and then I assume her mom or dad or somebody came along and did like a drawing over top of it. So I had Julia do this little scribble on my drawing tablet, and then I gave myself 30 minutes or a little less than 30 minutes to come up with a picture back there, and made a purple sky and was thinking about outer space and stuff. So here we go. Now I'm coloring. Now, if you're wondering, I use Photoshop and just standard brushes. And the way that you can kind of get this effect that I'm doing right here is using like the opacity turned way down on the pen stroke. So if you go over it once, it only, like when you choose white, it doesn't make it absolutely white. It just sort of shades it in, and if you go over it three or four more times, then it'll make it turn white, so you can kind of do shading that way. Anyway, shoot, looks like I'm drawing the spaceship, but I didn't get it in the recording. So anyway, you'll see it here in a minute. The drawing. It took me a little less than 30 minutes, but here it sped up, I believe, 8 times, okay? So I don't draw this fast, actually. That's what I was going to tell you. Darn, I'm really disappointed I didn't get that spaceship. Anyway, I came down here, drew a planet, another planet, and now I'm drawing a little character. Like I said, I did see Star Wars, The Force Awakens last night. It was awesome, by the way, and I would recommend it. Go see it 3 or 4 more times if you can. Anyway, here comes this person holding a staff of some sort. It's glowing on the top. I don't even know what this is, but this is the drawing. And it was fun making it with my daughter, Julia, who's 4. Oh yeah, there's a cool little horizon, city in the horizon. That's pretty cool. Yay! Now check it out. Who here remembers human highlight film Dominique Wilkins? One of my favorite players of all times. He was awesome. The thing about him that I loved is he could jump, and he'd make spectacular dunks all the time. And as a kid growing up, my very first favorite player was Dr. J, Julius Erving. That was a long time ago. Anyway, he was dunk spectacular. And Dominique Wilkins was right up there with Dr. J. One thing I loved about Dominique Wilkins, he would do the putback dunk where, the ball would come off the rim. And he would just be up there ready to throw it down. And oftentimes he would do it over top of another player, one of the defenders. So anyway, I was just remembering that and wanted to do a quick little animation. This is it. Wait, this is it right here. And it just took me like an hour to do this quick animation sketch. And this is like 1.5 seconds of rough, really rough animation. So it gives you an idea of how long animation might take. You go see these Disney Pixar movies and they have like hours and hours and teams of hundreds of animators going crazy on this stuff. So me, little old Paul in my little pod cave studio here, I don't get a lot done, but what I do is fun.
Okay, hey, here I am in another spot in my studio, which is just kind of to the left of my computer. My computer is right over there. And just trying to show off. Anyway, the last thing I'd like to talk about today is I did a little documentary on Sabutio in America. I went to the national tournament in Chicago to play Sabutio. And now, Sabutio is not necessarily a sport, I guess. It's a debate whether it's a sport or not. I don't care. It's fun. I have fun playing it. I love soccer, football, whatever you call it. And it's like a good simulation game. I grew up with electric football, and it's similar to that, but to me, a lot better. It involves a lot more skill, and I like painting the players and collecting the teams, and I've got my little Sabutio pitch. So anyway, I had a lot of fun, a lot of great players. I lost every game. I got smoked every game when I went to the national tournament. But I had fun being there and just seeing the players that they all brought their teams in like these fancy cases. I had a shoebox. So after the national tournament, one of the first things I did, I'm like, I can't do that again. I felt embarrassed, going to play these guys. They had all these cases. So I got myself a proper case. Put my favorite team's logo on the front. And anyway, that's not what I'm carrying on about. Don't get me sidetracked. Anyway, so I made this little documentary. It was fun to make. I interviewed, quick interviews of all the players there. And then I started piecing it together, and it was fun. I had some video footage of the games that people had taken. And I also had, at about the same time I was putting that together, I had gone to some film festivals where some documentary filmmakers were there, and I spoke to them, and I found out, like, my documentary approach was real flawed. But regardless, I made a documentary in my amateur way, and it's called Sabutio in America. And so you can check it out. It's on this channel. And anyway, I got some commentary from a couple of guys. I assume they're European or something. And they said this is not Sabutio, that it's table soccer and not Sabutio. I wasn't sure what they meant, so I thought I'd give them a fair chance to ask or to answer. So I just asked them, what do they mean? I didn't understand. Like, are they talking about the rules or the quality of play? And they gave me like some snarky remarks. You can read it on my comments. And so I kind of assumed that they were talking about some rules. And they were talking about maybe the quality of play. I'm not sure, because there's a few guys in America who can hang with the Europeans neck and neck. So I'm not sure what they're talking about, a quality of play. But anyway, it seemed as if their attitude was a little bit elitist, I'll say. And so I wanted to just talk about what I think about that. I think that's like the worst attitude that you could possibly have when it comes to sports. I love sports. I grew up with sports, and I think they're great for kids and adults and everybody. I think they're great for your mental and physical health, for your spiritual health. I mean, it's fun. Keeps you healthy and young. Sports are great. And here's something I believe about sports. I play sports to win. That's the point of playing a game. But when you go out and you give it all you got, and then you, whether you win or lose, at the end of the game is over. And you and your opponents can be friends, particularly if you got into a heated competition, or you may have hated that guy or that girl when you were playing against them. But when it's over, you almost bonded through that competition. You have a healthy respect for each other. And to me, that's great. You won't get that if you're just playing to have fun or you're just playing to learn, play to win. That's what I think, personally. Not everybody agrees with that. I found out as my son started playing soccer. But anyway, that's another story. Anyway, this elitist attitude is not good. When my son started playing soccer, he had never played before. He was like 9. He wasn't even into sports. He was like into Star Wars and fishing and stuff like that. So I'm like, you need to play some sports, I think, you know. And so he picked soccer. We went out and he played for the community ed here in the town where I live. And that's an introduction to soccer. It's for kids that need to get out and play, or their parents don't want to, you know, spend a fortune and travel all over the town. Kids just are having fun. Some kids don't want to be there, but their parents are making them. Some kids really love it, and like my son, played there for a couple years and was ready to move on to the next level. Well, I had gone to a practice one time with the community ed team, and one of the coaches from, there was a mix-up as far as what field was supposed to be used, and one of the coaches from the higher level soccer teams, which is club soccer, which is for people that want their kids to play in a more competitive environment. It costs a ton of money, and you got to travel all over and dedicate a lot of time, but it's great for the kids that want to compete and want to dedicate themselves to the sport. So anyway, there's coaches from one of the club teams had kind of got mixed up with coaches from one of the community ed teams, the introductory level, I'll call it. And the coach from the club team said, you know, oh, that's just the community ed team. They are, you know, I can't remember exactly what he said, but he acted as if it wasn't important what they were doing. And that just really rubbed me the wrong way. I mean, that should be the opposite. And I noticed this about people in sports that I like. For example, my son, whenever he gets a chance to an opportunity to show somebody the game, it doesn't matter if they're young or old or you know what their skill level is, he seems to truly enjoy just demonstrating the game, showing off, you know, but also trying to get them to play. And I think that comes from just loving the game. And it's a game. And if you have fun doing it, then you can share that with other people. And to me, that's the best thing about sports. And this elitist attitude of like, okay, I'm playing this game, you're playing, what you're doing is something else, you know. You're not at my level. That's the wrong attitude, and that doesn't help the sport. It doesn't help any sport. And for me, that goes with life. And my kids have heard me say sports is not just about the game, it's about life. And I believe that, and so I kind of responded harshly to these guys on my little YouTube channel about, you know, being elitist and the attitude that they, I thought, were kind of demonstrating. I don't know these guys. I'm sure they're probably nice guys. You know, they're just having fun. I understand that. I don't take it too seriously. But, yeah, I believe that sports should be open. And that's all I got to say. Anyway, play some Ludia. Have fun.